Jesus. Okay, I would like to thank the organizing committee for the present, for the organization of this event, and for hospitality. Okay, I will start with a brief survey of results on Burnside problem. So in 1902, Burnside wrote, a still undecided point in the theory of discontinuous groups is whether the order of a group may not be finite while the order of every operation it contains is finite. To be able to understand or to formulate this in the modern language, we will require a few definitions. So a group is periodic if every cyclic subgroup of G is finite. Group is said to be of finite exponent n if every cyclic subgroup of G is finite with order dividing the given number n. Group is locally finite if every finitely generated subgroup of G is finite. So in particular, every cyclic subgroup of G is finite, and therefore every locally finite group is periodic. So Burnside problem is whether the converse is true. So is every periodic group locally finite? But now we know that the answer to this question is negative. There are many famous examples. In particular, I'd like to mention groups constructed by Golod, Grigorchuk, Gupta-Sitke. There are some other interesting groups. An important common property of all these mentioned groups is that they are residually finite. I just recall one possible definition of residual finiteness is that a group is residually finite if it can be embedded as a subgroup in a Cartesian product of finite groups. Okay, the following form of the Burnside question attracted special interest. Suppose n is a positive integer greater than 2. Is every group of exponent n locally finite? Okay, the answer to this question is known to be positive if n is 2, 3, 4, or 6. If n is 2, this is absolutely elementary result. If n is 3, this was done by Burnside himself. The case where n is 4 is already quite complicated and was done by Sanov in 1940. The case n equals 6 is yet more complicated, was done by Marshall Hall in 1957. On the other hand, we now know that for big values of n, the answer is negative. In particular, the answer is negative whenever n is bigger than 8,000. Or whenever n is odd bigger than 665. For other small values of n, the answer is still unknown. In particular, the answer is unknown for n equal 5, 8, 9, 12. So the problem is still not quite settled. But I will now focus on the restricted Burnside problem. And it seems the restricted Burnside problem first was published in a work of Grün in 1940, and this happened several years after the death of Burnside, so probably Burnside never heard about the restricted Burnside problem. And there are several ways to formulate it. One maybe most popular is the question about finite groups. Suppose m and n are positive integers. Is the exponent of every is the order of every m generator finite group of exponent n bounded in terms of m and n only? And we can formulate the same question in the spirit of infinite group theory. So is every residually finite group of finite exponent locally finite? This second form really looks like almost like the original problem due to Burnside. And we already know that if we remove residual finiteness here, then the answer is negative if the exponent is bigger than 8,000. Or if we replace finite exponent here by periodicity, the answer is again negative, as is attested by those groups like Golod, Grigorchuk, and so on. Yet Quite remarkably, this question was answered in the affirmative. This was done by Zelmanov in the late 80s. And for this achievement, Zelmanov received the Fields Medal in 1994. Okay. One crucial step in the eventual solution of the problem was made by Hall and Hickman in 1956. They reduced the problem to the case when n, the exponent, is a prime power. So the problem was shown to be basically about finite p groups, which are of course nilpotent. And the one big advantage of working with nilpotent groups is that they admit a treatment using Lie algebras. And this Lie ring techniques was really particularly helpful in the context of the restricted Burnside problem. So Zelmanov solved the problem in the late 80s, as I mentioned, using Lie algebras. And in particular, while working on the problem, he established the following theorem. Let L be a Lie algebra satisfying a non-trivial polynomial identity. And suppose that L can be generated by finitely many elements, such that every product in this fixed set of generators is ad nilpotent. Then the whole algebra L is nilpotent. So this Lie theoretical result proved to be really a very helpful tool in treatment of some other group theoretical problems. Actually, here I must say that, in fact, Zelmanov first published just a particular case of this theorem, and he deduced the solution of the restricted Burnside problem from a particular case of this theorem. So a particular case of this theorem rendered a Fields Medal to its author. It's very natural that the general case must be really a great theorem with a lot of applications. So my purpose in this talk is to illustrate, exemplify, what kind of group theory can be done using this theorem. So I will not talk about ring theoretical aspects of this theorem, in particular about its relation to so-called Kurosh problem, which is a ring theoretical analog of Burnside problem. I will just describe several group theoretical results whose proof really is based on this theorem, and I think whose proof really cannot be obtained without this theorem. Okay, so I would like to start with groups in which all commutators have finite order. In 1961, MacDonald wrote, "No one seems to have decided whether a group in which all commutators have finite or bounded order can have a non-periodic commutator subgroup." I just recall that an element of a group G is commutator if it can be written in the form of x inverse, y inverse, xy, where x and y are elements of the group. And the commutator subgroup, usually denoted by G dash, is a subgroup generated by commutators. It's well known that an inverse of a commutator is again a commutator, but the product of commutators in general is not a commutator. And so this question really makes sense, and this turned out to be a very hard and interesting question. Later in the 90s, Mazurov formulated this as a problem in Kourovka notebook. He just slightly changed the form. So in Mazurov's version, the problem is, suppose that all commutators in a group G have order dividing a given number n. Does it follow that G dash is periodic? Okay, some early results on this problem. First was obtained by MacDonald himself, who proved in 1961 that if all non-trivial commutators in a group G have order 2, then G dash is periodic and it even has finite exponent dividing 4. Next, in 1967, Narayan Gupta proved that if all non-trivial commutators in G are of order 3, then G dash is periodic. But in this case, we still don't know if G dash is actually a finite exponent. So that's still an interesting open problem with a group in which all commutators have order 3 have finite exponent. Okay. In general, however, the answer to McDonald's question is negative. In 1999, Deryabin and Kozhevnikov showed that for every big odd integer n, there exists a group in which all commutators have order dividing n, but g dash is non-periodic. Independently, about the same time, this was also shown by Adjan. However, in sharp contrast with these negative results, in the case where a G is residually finite, we have actually a positive development. So we proved that if N is a prime power, and G is a residually finite group in which all commutators have order dividing N, then G dash is locally finite. Note that in general, as we know, a periodic residually finite group need not be locally finite. So here we have a surprisingly strong result, and the conclusion is stronger than originally was expected. G dash is not just periodic, but even locally finite. So after this, people start to talk about so-called dichotomy. It's maybe the most interesting phenomenon discovered in the context of the restricted Bernstein problem, that generally says that the nature of residually finite groups is really very much different from that of other groups. Okay, it's still unknown whether this theorem can be extended to the case where n is not a prime power. So just we have a problem. Suppose that all commutators in a residually finite group G have order dividing a given number n. Is g dash locally finite? If we compare this question with the original Bernstein problem, restricted Bernstein problem, the difficulty here is that we do not have a good analog of the Hall-Higman theory. We still cannot reduce the problem to a Lie theoretical one. Say, if the answer to this question is positive, if we consider residually nilpotent groups, then everything works fine. But with the Hall-Higman theory, really, we have a trouble here. And just the question is open. On the other hand, there are some partial results in this direction, even some exotical ones. In particular, we proved some time ago that if any product of 68 commutators in a group G has order dividing n, then G dash is locally finite. So this number 68 comes from a result of Dan Siegel, who proved that, among other things, he proved that in a two-generated finite soluble group, every element of the commutator subgroup is a product of at most 68 commutators. And then we showed that if a Hall-Higman theory can be developed for two-generated subgroups, then it can be developed for all groups. So, by the way, here, when we work with this problem, our group G is not even finitely generated. But still, knowing how to deal with two generated subgroups really helps a lot. Okay. So now I would like to talk about something else, another topic, and it's about Hall's problem on conciseness of group words. So let W be a group word, which is just a non-trivial element of the free group on free generators x1 to xk. So in any group, we can define the verbal subgroup corresponding to the word. The word W can be also seen as a function of k variables defined on any group G. And so the subgroup generated by the values of this function is called the verbal subgroup corresponding to the word W. A good example of a verbal subgroup would be the commutator subgroup, and it's exactly subgroup generated by all values of the commutator word. Okay, so a word is concise if the verbal subgroup is finite in any group where the word W has only finitely many values. Again, a good example of a concise word would be a commutator. It's known that if a group has only finitely many commutators, then G dash, the commutator subgroup, is finite. Maybe that's not obvious, but that's a theorem. And so certain words certainly are concise. And Philip Hall asked whether every word is concise. The question was asked in the 60s, but eventually a negative solution to Hall's problem was given by Ivanov in 1889. But on the other hand, before that negative solution was found, we had a lot of positive results. In particular, Jeremy Wilson showed that all multilinear commutator words are concise. So multilinear commutator words are just words that can be written using brackets, commas, and variables, and as such, they have form of a multilinearly commutators. So when written in such form, no variable can appear twice in such word. Okay, other results to this effect. Mirzlyukov showed that every word is concise in the class of linear groups. Turner Smith proved that every word is concise in the class of residually finite groups, in which every quotient are again residually finite. Here I must say that in general, a quotient of a residually finite group is not residually finite. This is clear since, for example, free group is residually finite, so every group is a quotient of a residually finite group. On the other hand, sometimes, of course, quotients are residually finite. In particular, if G is a finitely generated nilpotent group, then every quotient is residually finite. So basically, Turner-Smith solved the Hall's problem in the affirmative, in the class of nilpotent groups. Okay, negative solution was obtained by Ivanov, who constructed a group that has admitting a word with only two values in the group G. And one value is, of course, trivial, and only one non-trivial value. But that non-trivial value generates an infinite cyclic subgroup, so that was a negative solution. But then it was noticed that the group constructed by Ivanov is not residually finite. So recently, Hall's problem for residually finite groups was raised independently by Heiken, Sapirain, and Siegel. In fact, Heiken formulated it for profinite groups, but in this particular instance, the question for profinite groups is just absolutely equivalent to the question about residually finite groups. Okay, and it happens that in some sense, the residually finite case of the problem could be even more interesting because it allows use of a greater variety of tools. In particular, that stuff related to the restricted Bernstein problem seems to be quite helpful here. So I'd like to mention some results that we had in 2014 in a joint work with Achary. We proved that whenever Q is a prime power and W a multilinear commutator word, the word W to the Q is concise in the class of residually finite groups. I just recall that it's known that every multilinear commutator word is concise in the class of all groups, but nothing about its powers is known for the class of all groups. So this really was a new result that shows that Hall's problem for residually finite groups is really quite different from the general case. And again, it's unclear how to extend this to the case where a Q is not a prime power. The trouble again is that we don't quite have an analog of the Hall-Higman theory that could be used in this case to reduce the problem to some kind of nilpotency. But just in some cases, we were able to make progress. In particular, in the case when W is just a nilpotent word, just a long left norm commutator, x1 to xk, we could prove that any of its powers is concise in the class of residually finite groups. And this was done in a joint work with Robert Guralnik. And this particular result with Guralnik doesn't use Zelmanov's theorem, so it's just kind of exceptional result for this talk. Okay, and of course, as I said, it's still unknown whether this word would be coincides in the class of all groups. Now, I would also like to discuss results that we obtained in an ongoing project with Morigi and Tommy about conciseness of words of Engel type. So first, what is an Engel word? It's just a long commutator of two variables, x and then n times y is repeated. So it's not a multilinear commutator, since y is usually repeated more than once here. So a word of such form is called an Engel word. And groups in which all values of the an Engel word are trivial are called an Engel. There is lots of interesting questions about such groups. It was conjectured in the past that all of them are locally nilpotent. And the conjecture was proved to be true by Havas and Voynli, but only for n at most 4. The general case is still unknown, but the expectation now is that the result would be negative, as it was more or less announced by Reeves and Johas, that for big values of n, really the group doesn't need to be finite, to be residually, to be nilpotent actually, sorry. Okay, but we are mostly interested with residually finite groups, and in this case the situation is much better. John Wilson proved that locally nilpotent n-Engel groups are, sorry, John Wilson proved that residually finite n-Engel groups are locally nilpotent for any n. So that means finitely generated residually finite n-Engel groups are nilpotent. Okay, and about the conciseness of Engel words, Fernandez, Alcobert, Morigi, and Trausson showed that an Engel words are concise if n is at most 4. The question for n bigger than 5 remains unknown. On the other hand, using the result of Wilson about local nilpotency of an Engel residually finite groups, it's not difficult to show that for any n, an Engel word is concise in residually finite groups. So we studied various generalizations of Engel words. We obtained rather a lot of results. Just as an example of our results, I would like to mention one theorem here. So suppose W is a multilinear commutator word and Q a prime power. And then for any integer n, we consider the word which is obtained by commutation of W to the Q with another variable n time. So we showed that also this word is concise in residually finite groups. And of course the proof is mostly based on Zermanov theorem. Here I must say that these words are so complicated, there is absolutely no chance that someone would come anytime soon and prove that these words are concise in the class of all groups. So these are more illustrations to that phenomenon that I mentioned, that dichotomy between the residually finite and the general case. Okay, as the last topic for this talk, I would like to discuss groups with restricted centralizers. So a group is said to have restricted centralizer if the centralizer of every element G is either finite or of finite index in the group. This concept was introduced by Shalev in 1994, who showed that a profinite group with restricted centralizers is abelian by finite. So abelian by finite, in other terminology, would be virtually abelian. Of course, nothing like this could be shown for abstract groups, as for example, there are examples of so-called Tarski monsters. These are finitely generated, infinite groups in which every proper subgroups are finite. existence of Tarski monsters was proved by Olshansky and Rips independently. And of course this rules out any kind of result like this. Actually, Shalev was interested at that time in existence of some kind of monsters for in the class of profinite groups. So quite possibly his motivation for this theorem was comes from that questions on the existence of monsters. Anyway, so with De Tomy and Moriggi we obtained some verbal variation of this result. Namely, we proved the following theorem. Let W be a multilinear commutator word and G a profinite group in which all centralizers of W values are either finite or open. Then the verbal subgroup is abelian by finite. By the way, when we work with profinite groups, we observe that centralizers are closed, and therefore if centralizer has finite index, then it's open. So instead of talking about centralizers of finite index, sometimes I will just say open centralizer. Okay, I would like to describe some steps in the proof. So first, I recall a well-known definition. A group is an FC group if the centralizer of every element in G has finite index. This is of course the same as to say that every conjugacy class in G is finite. A group is a BFC group if every conjugacy class G is finite and they all have bounded sizes. That is, there is a common bound for the sizes of all conjugacy classes. A famous theorem of Bernard Neumann says that a commutator subgroup of a BFC group is finite. Of course, nothing like this can be proved for FC groups. It's easy to construct an example of an FC group whose derived group is infinite. But Shalev observes that a profinite FC group actually has finite commutator subgroup. This is because of compactness, of course, and using Baer category theorem, not difficult to prove this. Okay, recently in a joint work with my student in Brasilia, Glaucia Dierings, we obtained a BFC type theorem for commutators. Namely, we proved that if conjugacy classes containing commutators have finite and bounded order in a group G, then the order of the second derived group, G double dash, is bounded in terms of M. That's precisely like Neumann's theorem, but the conclusion is about the second commutator subgroup. And then with De Tomy and Moriggi, we extended the above result to the case of all arbitrary multilinear commutators. And also in the spirit of Shalev's theorem, we obtained a non-quantitative version for profinite groups. Namely, if W is a multilinear commutator word and G a profinite group in which all W values have open centralizers, then the verbal subgroup has finite commutator subgroup. Okay, all this will be used in our theorem on restricted centralizers. So suppose that G is a profinite group in which the centralizers of W values are either finite or open. So we want to prove that the verbal subgroup is abelian by finite. First, let's consider the case when G contains a W value of infinite order. So the element X generates an infinite procyclic subgroup, which is of course abelian, so it's contained in its centralizer. Just the centralizer of X is infinite and therefore it is open. Moreover, any other W value that just happens to be inside the centralizer of X must also centralize that infinite procyclic subgroup generated of X. And therefore it also has an open centralizer. Just we have a situation when really a lot of W values have open centralizers. And okay, I will skip, of course, technical details and just the result that the group, that the verbal group subgroup is abelian by finite can now be deduced from our results on FC groups. Just from now on, we can assume that all W values in the group G have finite order. This situation is reminds the situation that when we worked on groups with finite with commutators of finite order. Okay, so when we worked on groups with commutator finite order, in some situation we were able to prove that the verbal subgroup is locally finite. Then we needed n to be prime power. Here the situation is more complicated, and we have no information on possible orders of W values, but still we have a strong condition on the whole group about restricted centralizers, and the group is profinite. In short, using the stuff related to the restricted Bernstein problem, using also Zelmanov theorem and some other stuff, we were able to develop some kind of Hall-Hegman theory for our group, and really to deduce that the verbal subgroup is locally finite. And at this point, of course, a lot of other tools became available to us, in particular, everything that was obtained in the theory of finite groups, the classification of finite simple groups. So we use Wilson's theorem on the structure of compact torsion groups that says that a compact torsion group has a series of characteristic subgroups, series of finite lengths, such that all quotients are either pro p for some prime p or topologically isomorphic to Cartesian product of non-abelian finite simple groups. Dealing with non-abelian finite simple groups is easy in this context. Easy using some other outstanding results, like there is a relatively recent theorem due to Liebig, O'Brien, Shalev, and Tieb that says that every element in a non-abelian finite simple group is a commutator. So we deduce that every element in a non-abelian finite simple group is a W value for any multilinear commutator word. And then it's easy to extend this to the case when G is a Cartesian product of such groups. So if we have a Cartesian product of non-abelian finite simple groups with our conditions on centralizers of W values, in fact, it just follows that the whole group is a group with restricted centralizers. Just every element has either finite centralizer or centralizers of or open centralizer. So by the original theorem of Shalev, it follows that the group is actually finite. So in this series, all quotients that are not pro p groups are actually finite. Now, dealing with pro p groups also is not difficult. It's not difficult to show that a torsion pro p group that has at least one element with finite centralizers actually must be finite. And if it doesn't have elements with finite centralizer, then it must be an FC group. So in any case, it's both dealing with simple cases easy, dealing with pro-p cases quite easy. And just eventually we prove our theorem just by induction on the length of this series. Okay, but I think I don't want to give too many technicalities here, and I will stop now. Gracias.
I just want to ask, in this theorem of Shalev and results that you were describing at the end of the talk, is it possible somehow to replace condition on centralizes, instead of put a condition of centralized, condition on normalizes of cyclic subgroups, profinitely cyclic, procyclic subgroups.
Normalizes on procyclic subgroups. So yeah. That would be.
It would be either normalizer is open, or it is finite extension of the original cyclic group.
Actually, my first reaction is quite positive, yes, because the normalizer of a procyclic subgroup is almost centralizer. Not quite, but almost.
Well, up to cyclic subgroup.
Okay, I guess a lot can be done.
But you cannot claim that the centralizer is open anymore, because it is.
Okay, right now I don't know what would be the final result on this situation, but my feeling is that this is something that can be done.
In profinite context, it would be interesting. Maybe pro P is less interesting, but profinite is interesting.
Okay, so maybe I'm lucky that we work in the same department. We will talk about this.
Another question?
Thank you.